Welcome to CE Conversations, a clinical podcast presented by Creative Educational Concepts designed to improve clinician performance and optimize patient outcomes. This session, Meeting Complex Challenges in Proteinuric Glomerular Disease, an expert review of emerging data and novel therapeutics for IgA nephropathy, is accredited for 1 hour of ACCME credit and is supported by an independent educational grant from Travere. To earn CE credit for this activity, please visit the link in our show notes to complete the post-test and activity evaluation at the conclusion of the podcast. With that, we'll turn it over to our expert faculty.
So, a very good evening to you, and it is my pleasure to discuss this session where we'll talk about proteinuric glomerular disease and some of the complex challenges that we face when we manage patients with these diseases. So the focus will be on emerging data and novel therapeutics for IgA nephropathy. My name is Dr. J. Radhakrishnan, and I am a professor of medicine at Columbia University in New York. And joining me is Dr. Richard Lafayette. Richard is a professor of medicine at Stanford University in Stanford, California. So the objectives for today is that we will examine the pathophysiological processes which drives glomerular diseases, and in specifically the importance of proteinuria as not only a clinical hallmark, but it is a very, very important clinical trial endpoint. We would talk also about the diagnosis of IgA nephropathy and how do we diagnose this in reference to other glomerular diseases, and going from the clinical diagnosis to the pathology, and then finally to evidence-based therapy. And then we'll talk about novel therapies. What is the clinical trial basis for the novel therapies that are just coming out, and how do we use them? I was part of the KDIGO guideline committee, and what did the KDIGO say about treatment of IgA nephropathy, and how can we modify this with the availability of these novel therapies? And then what is the landscape for further investigation into the treatment for IgA nephropathy, and how can we improve clinical practice and patient outcomes using other therapies that are now being tested? And then finally, I shall present a case and we'll see how the diagnosis was made and then what are the treatment options available in 2023 in terms of how to manage this patient. So to start with and to end this talk, we would like to display some questions that you, the audience members, will answer. It's an online polling, and the answers will be given at the end. And I'd also like to remind you that during the talk, you can place your questions in the Q&A or the chat function in your webinar. And I'll take some of these questions at the end, depending on time. So here's the first question. Which of the following pathophysiological processes does not drive glomerular disease progression? So it's a does not drive question. So the first is high blood pressure, reduction in intraglomerular pressure, dysregulated immune mechanisms and inflammatory processes, and then finally sclerosis in renal tissue. So please make a choice. Great. So the next question is, which of the following markers may be considered a reasonable surrogate endpoint for glomerular disease progression? A, serum levels of VEGF, which is vascular endothelial growth factor, endothelin and angiotensin receptor mRNA on kidney biopsy. C is proteinuria and D is serum albumin. Please make a choice. Okay, the next one. Which of the following is the correct distinction of IgA nephropathy from other glomerular diseases? A, unlike FSGS, IgA nephropathy does not require a kidney biopsy to diagnose. IgA nephropathy is far more likely to occur in a pediatric population. C, no pharmacotherapies have been found to effectively reduce proteinuria in IgA nephropathy. And D, IgA1 containing immune complexes deposit in the glomerular mesangium. And here's the next question. According to the 2021 KDIGO guidelines for glomerular diseases, which option should be considered prior to standard oral glucocorticoid treatment for patients with IgA nephropathy whose proteinuria is more than a gram per day despite more than 3 months of optimal supportive care? So this is essentially 3 months of conservative management. What is the next choice? A, enrollment in the clinical trial. B, tonsillectomy for all patients. C, tacrolimus. And D, none. Use glucocorticoids right away. Please make a choice. Right, the next question is about the NefIgArd trial. This is a phase 3 trial. The part A was published of 199 patients, which investigated a targeted release formulation of budesonide for treatment of IgAN. Results of this trial lifted the FDA approval of this therapy for IgAN. What were the major findings at 9 months of therapy? A, the UPCR was 10% lower in the treatment group versus the placebo group. B, is the UPCR was 26% lower in treatment versus placebo. C, there was no difference, but the quality of life was improved in the treated patients. And number D is the UPCR was 10% lower in the treatment group. However, treatment was associated with a significant major GI adverse events. Please make a choice. And then which of the following is true of the 36-week phase 3 PROTECT trial and the FDA priority review decision for sparsentan as a treatment for IgA nephropathy? So this is to do with proteinuria reduction and the approval process for sparsentan. 60% mean reduction in proteinuria in sparsentan and the drug was approved. 20% mean reduction in proteinuria with sparsentan. Sparsentan not approved. 45% mean reduction in proteinuria. Drug was approved, 53% in UPCR with sparsentan. However, given the unfavorable risk-benefit profile, drug was not approved. So please make a choice. And then this is a patient example. This is a 33-year-old male who was diagnosed with IgA nephropathy 4 months ago. His past history is notable for obesity, type 2 diabetes, anxiety, depression, and was given a recent course of poorly tolerated oral methylprednisolone. He still has persistent proteinuria, 1.3 grams per day, and unchanged GFR of 80 mils per minute, despite 3 months of optimal supportive care. So which of the following are the most appropriate recommendations for this patient BF? Another 2 months of optimal supportive care and then start glucocorticoids if there's no improvement, as long as the patient can tolerate the drug. Initiate glucocorticoids now and keep going indefinitely. Initiate sparsentan or budesonide targeted release formulation, depending on the patient preference and medication costs. And then finally, initiate tacrolimus and glucocorticoids and taper over 3 months. So please make a choice. Great. So the answers will appear later during the talk. What I'd like to do now is to delve into the fundamentals of IgA nephropathy, which includes the pathophysiology, the role of podocyte dysfunction, and then proteinuria. So, as we know, IgA nephropathy is a disease of young people. So teens to the late 30s is when the disease gets diagnosed. And the unfortunate fact is that it's a lifelong disease. And up to a third of patients with IgA nephropathy will progress to end-stage kidney disease. And the longer you follow these patients, you'll find that in the absence of remission, the risk of ESKD is continuous during the patient's lifetime. And unfortunately, it does recur in transplants. Fortunately, not commonly, but even then, 20 to 25% of patients will experience recurrence, and some of these patients will again go into end-stage kidney disease. So there's a real unmet need for good therapies in this condition, and we'll be describing some of that during this talk. So the pathogenesis of IgA nephropathy has been worked out quite well over the last two decades. And if you look at the panel, the picture on the right, you can see this is being conceived as a four-hit model. So hit one is the production of an abnormal IgA1. It's galactose deficient. And when this appears in the circulation, there is actually an autoantibody against this, which is hit two. And this results in the formation of immune complexes, which then deposits in the mesangium of the kidney and incites an inflammatory reaction, which includes complement activation and drawing in of inflammatory cells, which ultimately leads to proliferation within the glomerular tuft and then eventually sclerosis if the inflammation does not abate. If you dig a little deeper into this process, and if you look on the left, we are seeing the lumen of the intestine, and there's a local, very well-developed immune system right there to fight pathogens and prevent them from entering the blood. And the B cells are very important in this. And what happens right here is in the setting of infection, these B cells get primed. But for a variety of reasons, rather than staying in the gut, these B cells, they mistraffic the IgA into the systemic circulation. And this IgA is abnormal, as we said. It's poorly galactosylated. And then that leads to the formation of antibodies. And if you see the top right, there is a genetic predisposition. And my colleagues from Columbia University actually were instrumental in describing up to 14 genes that were involved in this process, which affects various parts of this cascade. And eventually, the formation of the immune complexes leads to deposition within the mesangium. And you can see on the left, this is very classically seen in immunofluorescence, that you get large amounts of IgA within the glomerulus, and that leads to inflammation and kidney injury. So as a differential diagnosis, it typically leads to a nephritic syndrome, and the presentation can be in children with recurrent gross hematuria, but more commonly in adults, it's an insidious process with no symptoms. And unless someone does a urine examination or a serum creatinine check, it's very difficult to diagnose this disease. And as you know, there are no serological tests to diagnose this, and we are needing a kidney biopsy. And that is the only sure way to make a firm diagnosis of IgA nephropathy, where there is a predominance of IgA deposits in the mesangium. And in the absence of biomarkers, unfortunately, we'll be left with the kidney biopsy being the only way to make this diagnosis. What is important to rule out is that IgA deposition can occur not only in primary IgA nephropathy, but in a host of other conditions, notably IgA vasculitis, which is a systemic vasculitis. You may get IgA deposition in the setting of viral infections, notably HIV and Hep C, and B, inflammatory bowel disease, autoimmune diseases, liver cirrhosis, and then you may have a form of an IgA-dominant infection-related GN, and that's very important to differentiate from primary IgA nephropathy. So what has become very important is the pathologists now are very familiar with the MEST C-score, and what is important is that the MEST C-score gives us an idea of how the patient's going to do in terms of prognosis in the future. The clinical parameters and the MEST C-score have been combined into this International IgA Nephropathy Prediction Tool, which you can get on the web. If you just Google these words, you can find the tool. You can enter the data. And what this gives you is, at the time of kidney biopsy, or even up to a year after kidney biopsy, it gives you an idea of how the patient's going to do, depending on the time interval that you need to find out. So it could be as few as 2 years to as long as 5 years from the time of biopsy. To give you an idea of prognosis, in the KDIGO, we were very specific in saying that this tool is simply to look at prognosis. It does not give you any help in making treatment decisions. And it is a good springboard to talk to the patients about the future, saying that this is how the kidneys would do in the absence of therapy, but it should not tell you how to give therapy or which therapy to give the patient. What is very important is that proteinuria is the single most important marker of how the patient's going to do, aside from the kidney biopsy. So if you were to take one sort of metric of how the patient's going to do, it's going to be proteinuria. And you can see on this slide, if you take the time average proteinuria, if you take less than 0.3 on the top to greater than 3 grams, there's a stark difference in how the patient's going to do in terms of prognosis over the next several years. And also, what is important is, irrespective of the baseline proteinuria, if you are in remission, and you see on the right side, in people who achieve a partial remission under 1 gram, no matter which group you belong to, group 1 being the highest and group 3 being the lowest, your chance of maintaining kidney function is quite reasonable if you're able to achieve a partial remission. So the big question is, why does proteinuria in a glomerular disease lead to tubular interstitial damage, which is really what determines the outcome of IgAN nephropathy? It is thought that if you look on the left, that's the tubular lumen, that albumin gets absorbed into the proximal tubule. And in doing so, it activates in and of itself a whole host of pro-inflammatory cytokines that brings in inflammatory cells, and that leads to inflammation and fibrosis over time. And not only that, the complement system also gets activated at this level. And this is also an important aspect of progression in the way that proteinuria causes patients with IgAN nephropathy to experience CKD and ESKD. So proteinuria is very important. And reduction of proteinuria is a very, very important endpoint, not only in clinical trials, but clinically when we manage patients to see how they're doing. And what is also very important is that the time spent in remission really dictates what happens down the line. So if you look at this graph on the right, you see that if you look at up to 4 years and see what happens during these 4 years, so for every 3 months that the patient's in remission, your risk of progression drops by about 9 to 10%. So it is such a powerful tool to predict how your patient's going to do. And consequently, all your outer effort has to be driven towards dropping levels of protein in the urine for as long as possible. And what is also very important is that if you look at the clinical trial outcomes, if you look at results on the right and you look at the GFR slopes, so if zero means no change in the GFR slope and positive means you're maintaining or not preventing the slope from getting worse, and negative is a negative connotation, but the idea is that if you look at proteinuria, it is the single most important metric of how the patient's going to do in terms of maintaining the slope. So the worse, the higher the proteinuria, the steeper the slope, and the patients who have improved proteinuria will actually do very well in keeping the GFR slope unchanged or even improved. So I'm now going to hand over to Dr. Lafayette.
Thank you very much, Dr. Radhakrishnan. It's great to be here, and we're going to go straight ahead and take a deep dive into IgAN nephropathy as we figure out how to embrace these novel therapeutic approaches to really improve outcomes for our patients. And just to take one step back, we have to think about where we are, at least where we were 2 years ago, when the KDIGO group really said, well, how should we approach IgAN nephropathy based on what was the best available evidence? So if we do have patients who are at risk after their diagnosis of IgAN nephropathy with more than a half gram of protein per day, we really want to optimize their supportive care, which means getting their blood pressure systolic less than 120 to really get them on their maximally tolerated dose of ACE inhibitors or angiotensin II receptor blockers and see how they do. We want to embrace lifestyle modifications of diet and exercise. We know that patients over their lifetime with IgAN nephropathy can have increased cardiovascular risk. So it's good, again, to make sure they're not smoking, that they're exercising, that their lipids are reasonable for their age, and really to embrace our patients in this kind of care. But as you know, if the patients remain high risk for progression, then we have to think about other issues. And again, KDIGO really looks at the proteinuria as the ongoing risk factor for progression and really looks at the higher risk patients as being more than 1 gram per day of proteinuria. And as we'll get into, they really say, well, for those patients who remain high risk for progression, we should really consider clinical trial enrollment or perhaps glucocorticoid therapy. Now, clinical trials are great, and that's how we learn. And as we'll see, we've learned a lot through clinical trials over recent years. KDIGO makes it clear that the evidence at that time and even now for other therapies like these antiplatelet agents, anticoagulants, azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, calcineurin inhibitors, rituximab, and fish oil really is not sufficient, that these agents should be used any longer or recommended. So that could be discussed also with our patients. And then looking further ahead, that when these patients of ours are still at significant risk after the blood pressure management, after the maximally tolerated doses, as I mentioned, the main consideration by KDIGO is to get the patients in a clinical trial, because we need to learn more to help satisfy the needs of our patients and try to prevent progression of their kidney disease in a safe and effective way. And they further divide their patients to those with less than 30 mils per minute, suggesting a point of no return where additional therapies may not be worth it and you should just consider maximal supportive care, or those patients who still have somewhat preserved GFRs. And in those cases, one would think about their risks versus benefit of corticosteroids, taking patients who are older, have diabetes or other metabolic syndromes, obesity, bone disease, latent infection, and saying maybe they're too high risk for steroids. And for the others, still talking about what we know about risk benefit of corticosteroids for IgA nephropathy. Again, in other populations, perhaps tonsillectomy can be considered in Japan, maybe not elsewhere. Again, additional studies of mycophenolate look like Chinese individuals might do well. And whether it's really racial changes or the way studies are carried out will still need to be evaluated in the future. So as we think more about corticosteroids as the advised therapy, you will know that the study Stop IgA Nephropathy study was carried out. And in that group, more than 150 patients were randomized to receive either immunosuppression or standard of care blood pressure control and RAS inhibitors. And they did see a significant increase in the patients who came to remission from proteinuria. But when the patients were followed for a GFR change, there was no difference seen at the three-year endpoint, again suggesting that corticosteroids or a combination of immunosuppressive agents in some populations does not have a benefit on kidney disease progression. And in fact, that data, as you know, was carried out to 10 years of follow-up and still showed no benefit. On the other hand, the testing trial was carried out, again, predominantly in China and mainly with Asian patients, utilizing different doses of corticosteroids. At a full dose of corticosteroids, roughly equivalent to 40 to 50 milligrams of prednisone per day, the study was stopped because after the first couple of hundred patients were in, the severe adverse event rate was too high, above 10%. They had deaths in that study, and so the study was redesigned to go to a reduced dose. The reduced dose still results in doses between 30 and 40 milligrams of prednisone. They used methylprednisolone in the testing study, but there did emerge a kidney benefit. So there was an antiproteinuric effect of corticosteroids in testing. And as you can see in these figures, the placebo group had significantly higher rates of progression to loss of GFR or to kidney failure or due to death than the patients taking methylprednisolone, And there's longer follow-up on the left-hand side for patients in the full-dose cohort. Then on the right bottom in panel D, you can see that in the reduced-dose cohort, again, the data was shared only with 3 years of follow-up, but there was still a significant benefit to renal outcomes. So perhaps in some populations, carefully selected for safety, that corticosteroids can be efficacious. But still, we know that corticosteroids can lead to very severe adverse events in our population. And here was the adverse event table from the testing study. And you can see that compared to placebo, there's more severe adverse events among patients who are randomized to corticosteroids, to methylprednisolone, and predominantly a lot of those were related to infectious complications. And in the little inset on the bottom right of your screen, you can see that at full dose, it really was completely unacceptable that there was a six-fold increase of serious adverse events. But still, at reduced dose versus placebo, there's more than a doubling of serious adverse events. Again, these were predominantly infections. And so we need to be really cautious in the use of corticosteroids. And because of the mixed results in terms of efficacy and the consistent results in terms of safety, it'd be nice to look elsewhere. Another example of that comes from this study published a few years ago that looked at the use of corticosteroids in patients with primary proteinuric kidney disease. This was done through electronic health records, took 884 patients. Again, 534 were treated with steroids, 350 were not treated with steroids, and they utilized methods to keep the populations equal and to reduce confounding. But as you can see in the results, the adverse event risk was still 40% higher for any adverse event, about 40% higher high blood pressure, 80% higher events of diabetes, 50% weight gain, a more than threefold increase in fractures, and a doubling of infection. So the point is, if you're going to consider corticosteroids, let's be very serious about it, understand that they're serious medications, and yet in IgA nephropathy, the proof of efficacy, and particularly long-term efficacy, is yet to be established. So it would be very, very nice if we could move forward with new medications and look for other approaches to give us both efficacy and safety. And thankfully, no surprise to you listeners, is there are numerous investigational targets and agents being studied in phase 2 and phase 3 trials now, and that really our therapy for IgA nephropathy is already changing. And again, this results in here you have a slide of landmark clinical trials, those that are already phase 3, and starting from the top, utilizing targeted budesonide, a trial was accomplished where it looked at patients at high risk with more than a gram of proteinuria, assigned them to placebo versus these targeted budesonide capsules. And in part A, they reported that indeed they saw a significant reduction in proteinuria and a significant stabilization of GFR, and the FDA gave them accelerated approval. So for more than 1 year, at least in the United States, we've been able to give targeted budesonide as a therapy. And the initial results looked like the safety was reasonable. Part B has now just been recently resulted, but just in a press release, where their suggestion is that the proteinuria reduction continues and GFR preservation holds out to 2 years. So it's going to be exciting to get a formal report of that follow-up data. In the second study with sparsentan, likewise, high-risk patients with IgA nephropathy were randomized to sparsentan, which has a dual effect of blocking angiotensin II and endothelin. And again, this study compared the dual effect of sparsentan versus maximally tolerated dose of the angiotensin II receptor blocker. And as you also know, their results were reported showing a substantial reduction in proteinuria, and that very recently resulted in the FDA approving sparsentan for patients with IgA nephropathy, and we still await longer-term data to see if it's renal protective and really prevents progressive kidney disease. Similarly, another endothelin A receptor antagonist is in its phase 3 trial looking at results versus placebo in a high-risk group of patients with IgA nephropathy, and other mechanisms are also being explored, including factor B inhibitors. So complement plays an important role in IgA nephropathy. There's clear biomarkers of complement activity in the blood, urine, and kidney tissue of patients with this disease. And there's been lines of evidence supporting that the alternative pathway is active and that the lectin pathway is active, not so much the classical pathway. So we already have phase 3 trials going on to see if a factor B inhibitor to turn down the alternative pathway versus placebo will be active. Again, in phase 2, there looked to be a trend to reduce proteinuria that would be clinically important. So we await results of that study. And we also await the result of the phase 3 narsoplimab study, which is looking at a lectin pathway inhibitor versus placebo in high-risk patients with IgA nephropathy. Again, the phase 2 data looked interesting with safety and some efficacy in a small number of patients. So these are very exciting times because we already have two FDA-approved drugs looking at more specific targeted pathways in IgA nephropathy, and hopefully we could have more success. So coming back to targeted release budesonide, again, in the NefIgArd phase 3 study, those Part A results showed the percent reduction in the urine protein to creatinine ratio at 9 months compared to baseline. And as you can see, the differences are graphically shown here, that the patients in the targeted release budesonide group had a highly statistically significant 31% reduction in proteinuria. The placebo patients had 5% reduction. So the difference was both statistically significant and thought to be clinically significant, at least for the FDA to approve the drug. And again, we've had the option to prescribe this for our patients since a year ago, December. So that drug is available. And likewise, sparsentan was trialed in a strong group of patients enough to fulfill the power to show a significant difference of proteinuria between sparsentan group and the group with active control of maximally tolerated irbesartan at a maximum of 300 milligrams per day. Again, the primary endpoint being the change in baseline from the urine protein to creatinine ratio at week 36. And as you see, there was a 45% reduction in proteinuria compared to a 15% reduction in the active control groups. Again, this was a more diverse patient population where it was 2/3 white, nearly a 1/3 Asian. The PAO or targeted budesonide group was a little bit more strongly Caucasian, although by the end of the study, they had recruited a good number of patients internationally. So sparsentan, based on this antiproteinuric effect, was also FDA approved February 17th. And so now we have these two effective antiproteinuric agents to offer our patients. So there's further agents coming forward, and it's going to be important to start looking at not only the safety and efficacy together. We want to see the tolerability of these drugs. So for instance, for targeted release budesonide, the mechanism of action is to be a local effect. It's targeted to the ileum where the Peyer's patches are, and budesonide is metabolized by the liver in very potent first pass. So the idea is to get potent effects of the steroids on the Peyer's patches to release IgA and reduce IgA activity in the blood, thus reducing IgA nephropathy. And this targeted release formulation has generally been well tolerated. There's no head-to-head versus systemic corticosteroids, and you have to monitor for side effects. But again, this looks really well tolerated in that you can see some signal that there is some increased blood pressure and swelling, some acne, some skin changes, some facial edema, but these were characterized as mild and reversible, and severe adverse events, particularly infections, were not reported. So again, a tolerable and effective approach seems to be within our grasp. Again, sparsentan, similarly, we mentioned that it's an effective antiproteinuric agent. Prior endothelin receptor antagonists have been known to cause hepatotoxicity. Based on animal data, we know that endothelin blockers can cause birth defects in pregnancy. So there is a black box warning for sparsentan to monitor liver function, although direct hepatotoxicity has not been reported, and to mitigate against pregnancy. Women have to actually verify they're doing monthly pregnancy testing and maintaining contraception. Again, the drug looked overall well tolerated, but there was a slight signal towards swelling, towards relatively low blood pressure causing dizziness, minimal change towards hyperkalemia and anemia, but overall, again, a well-tolerated agent. And again, because it's already has intrinsic angiotensin II receptor blocking and endothelin blocking activities, you would not give this drug with other agents blocking these pathways. So again, very, very exciting initial data, and we do need to see how we utilize this agent in our practice. So additional evidence is emerging that patients can benefit from other agents. So interim results in phase two from the Affinity trial trying an endothelin receptor antagonist has shown that that approach can also reduce proteinuria in a small group of patients. Again, utilizing the factor B inhibitor has demonstrated that the urine protein to creatinine ratio at the highest dose can fall and fell by 31% in that group. And then finally, you see a figure that for the initial study in narsoplimab, the lectin pathway inhibitor, it showed that four patients at high risk of progression who had failed corticosteroid therapy had very substantial reductions in proteinuria ranging from 54 to 95% reduction. So we're seeing lots of promising activity in terms of treating our patients with IgA nephropathy. And at the very same time, you all know that we now have new classes of drugs approved for chronic kidney disease patients with proteinuria, and that's the SGLT2 inhibitors. So we already have an indication in standard of care that if you have a reduced GFR and you have, I think from those studies, proteinuria, then it's reasonable to treat patients with SGLT2 inhibitors if they don't have any major contraindication. But further than that, we have already seen subset analyses, such as was done in the very large DAPA-CKD population. You'll remember they recruited patients with GFRs of 25 to 75. They had to have a urine albumin to creatinine ratio of at least 200 and should have been on maximally tolerated BAS inhibitors. They could have diabetes or not. And within that study, there were 270 participants who were diagnosed with IgA nephropathy, 250 were biopsy-proven IgA nephropathy, and there was a very substantial renal protective effect seen in the DAPA-CKD study, suggesting that IgA nephropathy patients, like other CKD patients, really do enjoy renal protection. And again, whether it was just a diagnosis of IgA nephropathy or biopsy confirmed, was a similar degree of protection and a really fantastic reduction in risk here by 75% of doubling creatinine or going to dialysis or transplant. So again, DAPA-CKD looked very, very impressive for IgA nephropathy patients. Again, there's been some concern that that's a bit limited because these patients were really brought in as CKD patients with hypertension. Many had diabetes, but the EMPA-KIDNEY study overall looks good for CKD as well. And we can await analysis of those patients in EMPA-CKD, which is even a larger population with IgA nephropathy. So what I'll say is that IgA nephropathy is an important cause of end-stage kidney disease. It's a good example of disease that had limited treatment options and had an incompletely understood pathophysiology. However, there has been further understanding of the pathways of disease that should lead to diagnostic and prognostic therapeutic insights that steroids by themselves have unclear impacts and definite side effects. So we really need to look for other therapy. And again, conservative therapy with RAS inhibitors is our initial approach, but maybe that can be aided by using SGLT2 inhibitors, and now maybe helpful with sparsentan as well. Targeted release budesonide looks very promising now in both phase A and at least the earliest results from phase B. So that's extremely exciting. But we also have these trials of dual endothelin angiotensin receptor antagonists, complement inhibitors, B-cell therapies ongoing, all looking like they're promising, like they're well-tolerated, but we need the patient community and the physician community to stay together and continue to test these drugs to see what will emerge as the best drug for the right patient at the right time. And so hang in there. We're going to have lots of new approaches to IgA nephropathy. And in saying that, I'll turn that back over to Jay to talk about cases, and hopefully you'll enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you so much.
That was great, Dr. Lafay. I really laid the groundwork for what's available and what's in the pipeline for the treatment of this very difficult condition. So the idea here now is to discuss a case where we'll put the whole diagnostic and management concepts in a package, and we'll try to take you through this whole process and how to best help patients. So this is a young Asian male who comes to the emergency room for muscle spasms. Off note, he had a positive urine test for protein and blood and was denied life insurance because of this. Naturally, these patients go to a urologist first because of the blood of the urine, who does the entire workup and finds nothing abnormal and sends the patient home without further follow-up. So during the evaluation, he was found to be hypertensive in the 150s and then was given amlodipine and a diuretic with very reasonable control of blood pressure. However, his creatinine at that point, this is many years ago, was 1.02. And over 5 years, it had actually gone up quite a bit. His serum albumin is low normal. And at that point, he was referred for nephrology. On exam, in the clinic, he was found to be still a little hypertensive, 140 over 94, had trace edema. And at this point, he had 2 grams per gram of urine protein to creatinine ratio. He had 6 red blood cells. His creatinine was still 1.1. And all the serologies, including Hep B, C, ANCA, HIV, ANA, complements were all negative. And on the ultrasound, he had normal-sized but echogenic kidneys. And to cut a long story short, he had a kidney biopsy which showed mesangial and endocapillary proliferation with a few crescents, and IgA was strongly positive. So this was classic IgA nephropathy. His interstitial fibrosis and tubular atrophy was mild at 20%. And at that point, the pathologist gave him a score of M1, E1, S0, T1, and C1 for crescents. So here's the clinical and histological picture on the left. So his serum creatinine is 1.1. He has the score, as we mentioned. His blood pressure is now well controlled on an ARB and a diuretic. And his proteinuria hasn't gone down. It's still 1.5. So in the clinic, the first thing we'll do at this point is to calculate his IgA nephropathy international tool. So he'll be plugging all the numbers, and his 5-year risk for progression, that is doubling or end-stage kidney disease, is about 26%. And so for a young person, that is quite significant. So the discussion we'll have is, look, your risk of progression is high. You've been managed conservatively, but your proteinuria has not gone down. So let's talk about what's available, and we should jointly make a decision. And this is something that KDIG was very particular about when it comes to steroids. It's never a one-sided decision. The patient needs to be involved in the decision-making process. So on the right, I'll just list what's available right now in 2023. You have steroids orally. You have enteric targeted steroids, budesonide, FDA approved, sparsentan, just approved. It's a dual endothelin and angiotensin receptor blocker. You have SGLT2 inhibitor, one of which is approved. In China, mycophenolic acid analogs as monotherapy has been shown to reduce the risk of progression. The article just came out. And then in patients with higher risk of progression, especially the crescentic type, data are not great, but it's shown that cyclophosphamide does inhibit progression. And then finally, there's always clinical trials, Dr. Lafayette had mentioned, that if available, one should try to enroll patients. So 5 years ago, what we would have done is we would have had a discussion with the patient saying, look, your risk of progression is high, and probably the next step is oral corticosteroids. And then it's going to be a rough course because there are side effects. And we'll see at the end of 6 months how you do. Hopefully the inflammation will subside and so will proteinuria and things will change. In 2023, it's great that we have more choices. So now we can sit with the patient and say, although corticosteroids are available, in Asian patients like yourself, mycophenolic acid analogs could be used as monotherapy. However, we have two drugs that will limit some of the side effects seen with systemic therapies, and that is your targeted budesonide and sparsentan. And then SGLT2 inhibitors are FDA approved. We can still add that on. So what I would have done with this patient is, at the very beginning, I would put this patient on therapy with then ARB, yes, control of blood pressure, but start the SGLT2 inhibitors at that point, and then see what happens over the next 3 or 4 months. And then, since the patient is not rapidly progressing, one can wait and try either sparsentan as a substitute for the telmisartan, do not use both, or targeted enteric corticosteroids, budesonide. And it is entirely possible that you can use both in combination, because if you remember the four-hit pathway, the budesonide will work on the gut in limiting the production of the abnormal IgA antibodies, right? Whereas sparsentan works on the more distal hit 4 in reducing inflammation and fibrosis and directly affecting the podocyte function in reducing proteinuria. So in 2023, it is entirely possible that we may avoid systemic corticosteroids by using these drugs, which are either have a limited exposure to corticosteroids in the gut, or sparsentan, which is better than an ARB in terms of proteinuria reduction, or both. And if they fail, one can choose based on the profile at that point, either mycophenolic acid analog as a monotherapy or systemic corticosteroids in non-Asian patients. And of course, if the patient has rapidly progressing renal failure at any point during the process, one can pull out the cyclophosphamide and corticosteroids, albeit with the risk that your side effects will be much higher. So that sort of brings us to the point about the overall therapy has changed in 2023. And I hope with the discussion that we just had, we'll be able to look at your pretest questions and see what the answers are. So I'm going to read these questions out again with the poll that's going to occur at the end of each question. So let's have the first question. So which of the following does not drive glomerular disease progression? We had said high blood pressure, reduction in intraglomerular pressure, dysregulated immune mechanisms and inflammatory processes, and sclerosis in the renal tissue. Okay, the answer would be a reduction in intraglomerular pressure, and most of you got that right. Let's go to the next question. Which of the following are surrogate endpoints? So once again, VEGF levels, the levels of mRNA for endothelium and angiotensin receptor in the kidney biopsy, level of proteinuria, and then serum albumin. Let's vote. So clearly, most of you said proteinuria, which is absolutely right. And that is not really a clinical marker, but in clinical trials, that's the most important surrogate marker. Let's go to the next question. Which of the following separates IgA nephropathy from other glomerular diseases? So unlike FSGS, IgA does not require kidney biopsy. B is IgA nephropathy is more likely in pediatrics. C is no pharmacotherapies have been found to reduce proteinuria in IgAN. And lastly, IgA1 containing immune complexes deposit in the glomerular mesangium. And absolutely right. Immune complexes in the mesangium is really what defines IgA nephropathy from other glomerular diseases.
Next.
So this is the KDIGO guideline in terms of management. Which options to be considered before corticosteroids in patients who have IgA nephropathy and proteinuria above a gram despite 3 months of optimal care? So clinical trial, tonsillectomy, tacrolimus, none, go for steroids right away. What did the KDIGO say? So it is still a little split, but KDIGO basically said enrollment in the clinical trial because they really didn't have the data with these newer therapies back then. And the good news is that the KDIGO is going to update their recommendations every couple of years rather than wait for 10 years like we did the last time. Next question. The phase 3 NefIgArd trial of patients who were treated with the targeted release formulation of budesonide. So results led to FDA approval. And what was the major finding at 9 months? So UPCR 10% lower in treatment, UPCR 26% lower in treatment, no difference in UPCR, but improved quality of life, 10% lower UPCR, but major side effects with respect to the GI. So what was the choice here? Choice B, which is 26% lower UPCR in the treatment group, and that led to the FDA approval. Next question. Which of the following is true of sparsentan, that's a PROTECT trial, for IgA nephropathy? I'll go over this real quick. 60% reduction in proteinuria, sparsentan approved. 20% reduction, sparsentan not approved. 45% reduction in proteinuria, sparsentan approved. And then 53% proteinuria reduction, but unfavorable risk-benefit profile, not approved. Okay, next question. So this last is the 33-year-old male who has a lot of comorbidities, did not tolerate prednisone before, still has persistent proteinuria in the setting of IgA nephropathy with a GFR is 80. And had 3 months of optimal supportive care. So which of the following are the most appropriate for this patient? Another 2 months of supportive care and then steroids if no improvement. Start steroids now and keep going. You could start sparsentan or budesonide, depending on the patient's preference and medication costs. And then finally initiate tacrolimus and steroids for 3 months. And that is probably correct because you're trying to limit exposure to systemic steroids and drugs that are not absorbed, for example, budesonide or do not exert any significant glucocorticoid effects like sparsentan are definitely out there now and available for use. So thank you very much. So what I'd like to do is just two reminders. Please look at your chat and there are two links. One is to the program and get more information, including where to get your continuing education credits. And you can also get the general program information in the links provided. So I have a couple of minutes. I'll try to answer some of the questions that were asked. Can you comment on the role of finerenone and its predecessors? So finerenone is a non-steroidal mineralocorticoid drug. It's similar to spironolactone and eplerenone, but doesn't have the ring. So essentially does not cause any endocrine effects like gynecomastia. So unfortunately, it's not been studied yet in IgA nephropathy. It's FDA approved for diabetic kidney disease. I do use spironolactone and eplerenone in patients with IgA nephropathy to further reduce proteinuria if possible. But this drug is not approved, so you cannot get it for IgA nephropathy. The next question is generic formulations compared to TARPEYO. So the point here is that TARPEYO was formulated specifically to hit the Bayer's patches in the ileum, whereas the regular budesonide is not so targeted. There are no head-to-head trials and there are no data to see if the generic budesonide works or does not work. So beyond that, I cannot say much. And then finally, the thought about Jardian, which is another SGLT2 inhibitor. So at this point, although the trial is out, it's not yet FDA approved. And thus far, only the drug that's approved is EMPA. So we are going with that. Then how about tonsillectomy as a treatment? Why is it of benefit in Japan? And the answer is that this is the only country where mainly observational studies have been done. It's not been done outside Japan. So the KDIGO was quite careful in saying that in Japan, there's probably a benefit based on very limited data, but we do not have the same experience outside of Japan. And one thing to remember, it's very clear that in Asian populations, IgA nephropathy is different from, say, Caucasian populations in terms of progression, in terms of its natural course in biology. So it's not quite saying apples and apples. So one can certainly consider tonsillectomy if there's recurrent tonsillitis associated with flares of IgA nephropathy in patients outside of Japan. So with that, I'd like to thank you, and I hope this was useful to you in your practice. And please do come back and look at the site if you're not able to hear the whole talk and you'd like to download the information. And good night.
Thank you for attending this edition of CE Conversations. We hope it has been impactful for your clinical practice and, most importantly, for the patients you serve. Please proceed to the link in the show notes to complete the post-test and activity evaluation to claim your CE credit.